How much do you think healthcare should cost? The tragic reality is that for many Americans, the cost is their life. Ashley H. is an American whose dad didn't have health insurance and couldn't afford to go to the doctor. It wasn't until he went to the emergency room that he was diagnosed with untreated liver disease. He died weeks later. Ashley's mom faced a similar situation. She also couldn't afford to go to the doctor, despite having kidney disease, diabetes, and long-term pain that sometimes became excruciating. The story of Ashley's family is one that may be familiar to many of us, because it is so common in this country. Ashley's family could be any of our families. 25% of Americans report delaying medical care due to costs. 20 to 45,000 Americans die each year due to lack of insurance. I invite us to sit for a moment with the deep sadness, frustration, and outrage of these tragedies. These people's experiences are reminders that we have to learn from this. We have to learn from the financial logic that makes American healthcare feel less human than it should be while creating these preventable tragedies. Preventable is the key word here. My name is Young. My background is in health economics and public health. I'm also training to be a doctor. Today I'm here to do what doctors do and break some news to you. The good news, I'll start with the good news, is that America has two main ingredients needed to build a more affordable and life-saving healthcare system: intelligence and altruism. Now, the bad news is that traditional economics can lead to prioritizing money over patient well-being. Don't worry, there's some more good news. If we spread new ways of thinking about healthcare economics, we really redefine what is possible. I'd like to share some ideas with you today so that together we can redesign health economics to be for everyone. To start off, how is the healthcare system able to charge such high prices? The short answer is that healthcare has inelastic demand. Now, in economic terms, inelastic demand means that as the price of services goes up, the amount of services that people choose to use doesn't change by much. For example, if I need a surgery for cancer and you increase the price by $10,000, I'm still going to agree to it. Now, let's say you increase the price of the surgery by $100,000 for some reason. You know what? I'll still probably agree to it, and my family may even go into debt to pay for it. The point here is that health is precious, irreplaceable, something we're desperate to keep, and something we would pay a lot of money to keep. And that's just common sense to us as human beings. This is what gives healthcare businesses the ability to charge higher and higher and higher prices. Unfortunately, this logic does have several fatal flaws. If you tell me that my doctor's visits are going to be $200 per month, even if I value my health at $200 per month, if I'm living paycheck to paycheck and I only have $50 in savings because I need to pay for food and rent and childcare, chances are that I'm going to start skipping more and more doctor's visits and treatments. Remember the story of Ashley's family? This is how that kind of story happens. Now that we understand how healthcare is so expensive, the question becomes, why is it so expensive? The short answer is profit. Now, profit and economics are not the same thing. Profit means, how much am I earning compared to how much I'm spending? For example, if I sell a Philly cheesesteak for $7 and I spend $3 on ingredients and supplies, my profit is going to be $4. The thing is that businesses have to worry about profit. Businesses and their leaders come together and say, we need to make profit in order to keep running. If we're losing money or if we're only breaking even, what's the point of staying open? One of the methods of making profit is to increase your income by increasing your prices, which in the case of healthcare can actually hurt patients and their families. Now, increasing prices for this reason creates bigger problems too. Studies have found that high healthcare prices are the reason for America's higher total health spending compared to other wealthy countries around the world, which all have governments that guarantee universal healthcare. My question for you is, if healthcare has to be unaffordable to keep its business model running, should we even let it continue running as a business? Now, unlike private businesses, the government can provide resources without needing a profit. In fact, many of the public services we already use are not run like businesses. Healthcare could be a public service in which pharmaceuticals, insurance, medical devices, and healthcare are all provided under public health economics for the public good. The bottom line here is that economics does not need to involve profit. So far, I've shared some of the bad news of how and why healthcare is so expensive in America. I'd like to share some more hopeful news about how health economics can be used to save more lives using less money. Just now, I mentioned how one of the ways to make profits is to increase your prices. Another method that's commonly used is to decrease your costs by scaling up production. Scaling up production means increasing your production so that you're using your tools and resources more efficiently. I got another example. Let's say my friends and I want to each make Philly cheesesteaks for ourselves. Now, we got to each purchase the expensive kitchen space, ingredients, and equipment to make them ourselves. Now, let's say instead of doing that, we actually want to work together as a team and make cheesesteaks for all of us. We still need to buy the same type of equipment, but the cost of each individual cheesesteak is actually going to be cheaper. Now, the reason for this, it's very interesting, is that when we work together, we actually need less equipment, and the cost of the equipment is spread out over more individual cheesesteaks. It's actually less efficient for my friends and I to not work together. It's a similar situation in healthcare. It takes so many resources and logistics to get individual healthcare organizations up and running. Our healthcare system is broken into hundreds and thousands of individual healthcare businesses, and that's really not efficient. What ends up making sense under traditional economics is for healthcare companies to buy each other up and expand so that they can scale up production and become more efficient. The bad news is that this can lead to monopoly, just like the board game, where you only have one player or very few companies that are going to dominate the market, and they're able to charge higher and higher prices to patients because they're the only choice. Now, there's some good news here. I've got a lot of good news and bad news today. The economics of scale can be used in a more beneficial way under public health economics. Public healthcare systems could scale up production, increase their efficiency, and avoid the greed of private monopolies. Public healthcare systems could actually take the money that they save and reduce the cost to society, or increase the number of patients that they're taking care of, or do both. Studies project that universal public insurance in America would save 68,000 lives per year and $450 billion per year. That's a lot of money and a lot of lives. Most of these savings would come from reducing the inefficiency of having so many different insurance companies that do similar things. I'd like to close by discussing one of the larger counterarguments to the ideas I've shared today, which surprisingly also gives me the deepest sense of hope. Profit and making healthcare decisions based on money are so normalized in the society that it can be difficult to imagine doing anything different. For example, pharmaceutical companies often claim that without profit, there would be no motivation to create new life-saving drugs. Apparently, you need profit to motivate people to help people. Fortunately, this is only one option. Anyone who has been in healthcare spaces knows that the heart of healthcare workers and scientists is caring for people. This humanism, this altruism, it would continue under a public healthcare system. When you give healthcare workers and scientists the time and resources to care for their patients, discover scientific advances, and develop better treatments, the vast majority of them would do so without demanding profit as a reward. Something in our hearts, in our guts, tells us when we look into the eyes of a patient that they matter to us, and we want to help them, no matter who they are or how many resources society decides to give them. Now, this isn't just hypothetical. Every single day, good people in healthcare choose to sacrifice their comfort and time with their families so that they can care for their patients. Needless to say, the humanity of people in healthcare is inspiring. It leaves us with limitless hope that together we can build a better system, one that moves away from money and toward the patients who we dedicate our lives to. I hope that the ideas I've shared with you today have expanded your minds a little bit to the possibilities that exist when we put patients first in aiming for a better healthcare system. I want each and every one of you to leave this room today with some serious questions about our healthcare system. I want you to vote with that in mind. I want you to rethink your business model with that in mind. And I want you to unionize with that in mind, which we've already seen healthcare workers doing across the country. What happened to Ashley's family was tragic beyond words, and it should never happen to anyone. But it could happen to any one of us or our loved ones unless we stop it. Please join us in pushing for a truly affordable public healthcare system so that we can improve the lives of all of our people. Thank you.